to hear what's going on inside.
You just kind of got to get over your homophobia.
You need a brain expert.
It's not simple, it's not.
Because often their voices are not heard. Your voice is part of your life. It needs to be connected to who you are.
Who can be? I don't do what I got to do. I don't do male, I be male. I don't do gay, I be gay.
And this is how God made you, this is how I how God has made me.
Talk about that pain being in an anti-gay, anti-black world. You're not meant to be inauthentic for very long.
Well, I mean, perfect music. I just have to be reasonable. But when you were anyone the last day, God, I said, I'm going to say, Mom, did you see popcorn? A giant soda, and that didn't go wrong.
Thank you. I'd like to start this documentary, please be trailer, and I'm going to come down here. I hope everybody back and see this in the show. It's the, you know, all that man down there, right? You guys see the back? Anything you can ask me, I'm sure you can hear me. I'd like to begin this documentary because it sets the scene, it sets the tone for our conversation. I know I'm supposed to do a keynote speech, and when we see traditional keynote speeches, the person stands up there, and they just throw it on and on. I like to be more interactive. Maybe if I take something off, drum. It's not what it's like, it's not what I am for. But in all seriousness, I know some of you just got yourself set up. What I'd like to do is ask everyone to stand. Because the issues of HIV and mental health are so very important, especially in South Carolina, that I'd like us all to take a moment in silence to bring to our minds, call it out if you feel that you want to. Bring to our minds, bring into this large space someone you know who may have committed suicide. Someone you know who has died of HIV and AIDS. Someone you know is struggling with some form of mental health issue. And we perhaps are at our wit's end in how to address and deal with that person. Have you followed me how that a simple exercise kind of centers us and brings us and focuses us on our being here? This morning, I want to have a conversation with you about HIV being the intersection of HIV and mental health. Since HIV was realized more than 30 years ago, who are the people we know are most significantly impacted by the virus? was listening to Wilhelmina's board last night and watching the film, and I thought to myself, with all the HIV medications that we prepare and that we have, does anybody know how many of those medications have been designed for black and brown bodies? Or were they only designed for the white body and then put onto the black body? But since HIV came about, or was discovered or realized, the black and Latino communities were largely left unnoticed. And it was a case of putting one toxic medication after another. Just see if this works. Try this. But nobody ever stopped to consider. And even though we've come all this way in 2016, we're still not hearing that, because the CDC is saying, oh, let's try this new method. Let's try this new campaign. Let's do this, let's do that. But nobody's ever really stopping to consider what are the underlying driving forces that are contributing to HIV infections. Yes, it used to be predominantly men who have sex with men who were HIV positive. But now we see an increase in women, black women, Latino women, women of color, who are now the highest rates of HIV infection. But let's also not forget that they are the older men and women who are also a rising demographic for HIV infections. And also older black and Latino lesbian gay men and women who are also becoming infected. And many of them in their 60s and 70s are choosing not to take medication. Okay. Let's do some definitions. I know that each of you may all of you may know this, but I just want to just kind of like bring ourselves back and understand where we're coming from. What's a mental illness? Mental illness disrupts a person's thinking, feeling, mood, ability to relate to others, and their daily functioning. Mental illness refers to a disorder characterized by mood, dysregulation, thought, and or behaviors recognized by DSM-4 and 5. What is a mental health? Mental health, according to the World Health Organization, is defined as a state of well-being in which the individual realizes his or her own abilities, can cope with normal stresses of life, can work productively and fruitfully, and is able to make a contribution to his or her community. According to medical news today, mental health refers to our cognitive and or emotional well-being. It is about how we think, how we feel, and behave. Mental health, if someone has it, can also mean an absence of a mental disorder. Ladies and gentlemen, how many of you identify with any of these characteristics? How many of you know people who identify with any of these characteristics? So when we start to throw around language like somebody's mentally ill or somebody's mental health, do we know exactly what we're talking about? Do we know the definitions that we're referring to? Estimates are that up to 50% of people with HIV have mental illness, such as depression, and 13% have both mental illness and substance abuse issues. I'm just giving you these numbers and these facts in the beginning because I'm going to break off from this in a while. Because after a while, this becomes really annoying and frustrating to see these numbers. The Archives of General Psychiatry suggested that as many as one in three persons with HIV may suffer from depression. This is moving fast for me. The World Health Organization suggests that depression is projected to become the leading cause of disability and the second leading cause of entry to the global burden of health and disease in 4 years. And that by 2030, depression is said to become the leading cause of disability. By 2030, there is an estimated 450 million people worldwide who struggle with depression. I come from Guyana, which is a small former British colony in the south northeast coast of South America. As of 2014, the World Health Organization said that Guyana had the highest per capita rate of suicide at 4.2% per annum, with a population of just about 3/4 million. So we're talking an average of about 197 suicides a year. Just to put that in context of what is happening in our communities. When someone commits suicide, who is the first person that gets blamed for them?
That person.
Thank you. But why do we blame that person? Because we have been conditioned to think that a person who commits suicide is selfish. But have we ever stopped to take into consideration that the person who commits suicide is actually a victim of our collective selfishness? That in fact it is us, their families, friends, co-workers, who fail them. Who did not pay attention, who were just so concerned about each of our own individual selves that we didn't even think that somebody needs help. They were giving us a sign. Before somebody commits suicide, they telegraph their intention at least 3 months before, up to 3 weeks before they commit suicide, they tell you, I'm gonna kill myself. But how many of us will be like, I'm just joking, you'll get over it. Pray about it. Don't worry about it. Oh, don't worry, you're just going through a thing, you know. It's a sleep. But when action does happen, you might think he was gonna do that. I didn't really. Why did he do that? What was going on? But we remove ourselves from that responsibility. Is it because we're afraid? Is it because we're ashamed? Is it because we're embarrassed? You understand? Studies show that people who do not know they're HIV positive are more likely to engage in risk behaviors associated with HIV transmission. Research has revealed that some gay men or people who are engaging in unsafe sex were depressed because they were less concerned about the consequences. Let us sink in for a moment. If I don't care about myself, why should I care to put a condom on? Why should I care to ask the other person if he or she is HIV positive or not? And it's not confined to just men who are sex with men. It's also about opposite sex relationships. If we don't care about ourselves, then why should we care The CDC estimates that based on pretend data, every 30.7 minutes, someone somewhere across the country commits suicide. In 2010, there were 30,364 deaths across the country. Based on that data, suicide is listed in the CDC's surveillance and mobility report as a 10th leading cause of death. But does it really matter where along the spectrum that is in it? It is first or 100th? Is every single life important? That one life from suicide is one life too many? We know that the suicide rate for men is 90.9 times, more than 4 times compared to women. We know that more men commit suicide, more women attempt it. More men complete it. Let's look at South Carolina for a minute. And I'm sure you're all familiar with the situation. So it shouldn't be news. Suicide is ranked as a 9th leading cause of death in 2014. It's the 10th leading cause of death for blacks in South Carolina, including diseases of the heart, cancer, cerebrovascular disease, accidents, diabetes mellitus, chronic lower respiratory disease, Alzheimer's, nephritis or kidney failures, influenza, pneumonia, septicemia. Suicide ranks 7th of the leading cause of death in men, which is 192. This is South Carolina. Yesterday afternoon, my dear friend Catherine did a workshop presentation on social determinants of health. What was particularly interesting about his workshop is that Catherine outlined some of the issues that are taking place in our communities that are drivers for mental health destabilization. He was talking about housing. He was talking about access to health care. He was talking about poverty. He was talking about job readiness and education. But those are what I would call socioeconomic constructs. What about the sociocultural constructs that are drivers to mental health destabilization? In the documentary trailer that we saw just now, perhaps not quite as evident, but more so in the full-length documentary, at least 5 significant themes emerge about the psychosocial and sociocultural factors that contribute to depression and consequently HIV infection. We talked about sexual identity. So when a child is growing up and a parent discovers or realizes the child will be different, how many parents will try to beat the father out of that child? Because they don't want a father in the house. Because that father is going to bring embarrassment and shame on them. They're not going to be able to hold their heads up in church or in community. And child may not be able. He just may be displaying those tendencies and may not be. We talked about sexual abuse and trauma of young men and boys, where one psychologist said 1 in 6 boys are sexually abused, but that number being underreported because which boys would come forward and say that an older man touched him and sexually abused him, or which boys would come forward and say an older woman sexually abused him? Because our society conditions us to think that as long as you have sex, you are a man. As a matter of fact, we have the social and cultural norm as a form of transition from boyhood to manhood, where only adult men will take our 12-year-old sons to a brothel to be initiated sex by a prostitute. And what we call that? Growing into manhood, knowing what it's like to have sex with a woman. Or when you look at the instances of the rape culture we have, the sexual abuse culture of women, where it is okay for a boy to sexually abuse or have sex with a young girl, but she can't do the same because she's branded a slut, but he's branded a man. Am I saying something you don't know? You know what I'm saying? Now, what we do know is that when a boy or a child is being sexually abused, that child's entire neurological system becomes rewired. And they begin to see life through the lens of that abuse, through the trauma of that abuse. And understand that it does not follow that the sexual abuser is gay or lesbian. It does not follow that the victim is gay or lesbian. It may also be possible that the perpetrator is just continuing a pattern or a cycle as a domestic violence. Because that is all they know. So they see a young boy at about 10 or 12, and for them, that's a turn on, because that is what was done to them. Does that make sense? The next thing that came out in the documentary was the role of the church as a contributing factor to mental health destabilization. Do I need to go into that any further? Do I hear a dead silence? Do you want to talk about the church and its relationship with sexuality? Do I hear some dissent from back there? Well, let's just go there for a minute, man. Let's just go there for a minute. Okay, y'all want to take it there. Let's just go there for a minute. The religious belief system that you have, where did it come from? It's a Western European construct. So if the people who are giving it to you don't want you to practice your own sexuality, then what are they going to do? Let's hold on. We're mostly black and brown people in this room. Let's take a step back and go back to where we came from. How many of you in this room right now, because you're in the South, are so in tune with your slave ancestry? Let's go back there. Let's go back and look at how many of you see the new version of Ruth. Okay? How many of you know that in fact in Africa, before the European colonizers, before they brought their missionaries, that there are many tribes and cultures in Africa that accepted same-sex relationships? They worshiped them. They accepted them. They were part of their communities, part of their culture, part of their societies. Let's look at the book that's been written by, that is called Boy Wives and Female Husbands. Let's talk about the book that's called The Greatest Taboo, Homosexuality in Africa, which talks about the history
needs in the LGBT in Africa, indigenous context. You got what I just said? An African indigenous context. I don't mean an invasion of Dutch, invasion of Germans, invasion of French, Belgians, British, Spanish, Portuguese. Indigenous African cultures. So, and then similarly in those African belief systems and cultures, they have a way of dealing with somebody who, a member of their community, a member of their tribe or their village, who struggled with mental health issues. They would often put the person in a room or in one of the huts, build a hut for that person, put them in the hut, and counsel and work with the person. The chief, the shaman, everybody would do this. I'm going to go somewhere else now. Because we are now at this conference in a bubble. When we leave here, we got to go back out into the world. Ladies and gentlemen, yes, we are here at this conference. It offers this kind of camaraderie, a kind of belonging, a kind of like, you know, we're all together. I hate to use kumbaya because kumbaya actually has come back here, but in American context, kumbaya, we're all together. South Carolina, as you know, as well as I know, has not accepted the expansion of the UK. Okay? What does that mean for people, for men, women, black, brown bodies who are struggling with mental health and with each other? That combination, what does it do for them? It means they have little or no access. It means that their broken, shattered minds and bodies are discarded aside the road for the sake of corporate profits. You follow me? I know that many of us in this room perhaps work with state or federal government agencies. But I have to ask you this question. And I think it's a product of continued colonization. Is it we have forgotten who we are when we go to work with somebody? Because those are people who pay us, those are people who help us have a house, a mortgage, pay our car, and those help us for our crews. And help us to actually pay the tithes for a church to keep the fancy building, the huge chandelier, and the pastor driving the Mercedes. Having a relationship with all sorts of people. But because of that quasi-comfort life, how many of us sacrifice our integrity? How many of us sacrifice who we are as people just to go along? When we should actually take a stand, we don't, because we are afraid that we lose. When I hear of someone who's committed suicide, when I hear of someone who's just HIV, I feel that person. That I may not have done something more, that I could have done something more. I know I'm trying to work on some side complex. Okay? That I can't say the whole world. I can just do it one at a time. That is why the motto of my organization is, if by what I am doing, shut us down.
All right.
His healing begins. I think this afternoon, I'm actually going to continue these slides in a workshop that looks at how HIV and mental health from a neurobiological perspective. So if you're interested and you want to make it complete workshop this afternoon, welcome to have a better conversation or even keep a conversation about that. Okay, and I will tell you about the grand point with you. If you're not joining the lecture, the grand point with you.